Can I thank the First Minister for her statement? We're now going to move to a debate on the First Minister's statement on taking Scotland forward. At this stage, can I ask all members who wish to speak to ensure their cards are inserted properly and ask them to press their request to speak buttons. I now invite Ruth Davidson to open the debate. Ms. Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the First Minister for advance notice of her speech. With today's session, this Parliament begins the real work of holding the Government to account for the next 5 years. I believe that that task has never been more important. We get down to business today in the knowledge that decisions on education, on the health service, and on all our public services have been stacking up and now require our attention. Added to that are the huge new responsibilities this Parliament is soon to take over tax and welfare. No longer are we here simply to argue over how best the government spends a fixed sum. We now must decide how best we raise money, which people and businesses that money is taken from, and how we best grow the economy to ensure those funds increase. The rewards and the risks are great. What is clear to me is that if the last parliamentary session was about deciding the shape and identity of our country, this next parliamentary session should be about setting the policy direction and goals of our country for the coming years. For me, it makes facts, analysis and evidence-based policy provision all the more important. This is something that my group of MSPs will be determined to bring to this chamber and to its committees. The Conservative group was elected on a promise to provide a strong opposition to the Scottish Government. That doesn't mean shouting louder, emoting harder, or a more frenzied gnashing of teeth. Instead, we intend to provide a forensic challenge to the policies of this government. If the government wants support, then we want to see the evidence and the facts that back their plans up. And we will set out a clear vision for how we hope they will proceed. We want a government which uses the tools of the state to create a stronger society, which doesn't seek to crowd out individual freedom, but to liberate it, which offers support for communities and families to lead better lives, prioritising those who need it most, but which recognises that government cannot do it all, and that government at its best is not an imposition, but a partnership with society. The First Minister has been criticised for caution and inaction during her first 18 months of tenure. It's a criticism which has stung. But the fact is that the First Minister and her team now have a huge opportunity to build that partnership and use the next 5 years in office to make a real and lasting difference. But it does require the government to take the right course. Either it can take the easy option, which says just keep things quiet, manage the way around problems, take regular potshots at the UK government, all in the hope that the show stays on the road until the promised day of NDREF 2. Or it can take the harder road, a choice which focuses on bringing about long-term change right now. Change that won't be easy. Change that will cause conflict among vested interests and create hostility. Of that, I'm certain. But change that will show that this government has left its mark, that will show in a decade's time that this government wasn't just about one thing and one thing only, but that it made a lasting difference that Scotland can benefit from. We asked to be a strong opposition in this election because we wanted to encourage that better government, and that is the task we set ourselves today. On policy, the First Minister has said that the economy and education are her priority, so let me start on one and end today on the other. On the economy, we welcomed the news yesterday that inward investment is up in Scotland. A lesser woman than me might remark that it's good to see funds corked up due to the independence referendum now being released. But we shouldn't allow one set of good figures to blind us to the facts. Last year, Scotland's growth rate was 0.4% behind the UK's as a whole. Unemployment is rising again, up by 8,000 in the most recent figures. The jobless rate is higher than that of the rest of the UK at 6.2% compared to 5.1%. These figures, say the Federation of Small Businesses, are an amber warning for the Scottish Government. And that note of caution is being repeated by firms large and small across Scotland. Liz Cameron, the Scottish Chamber of Commerce chair, tells us that Scotland is now on a knife edge between further growth on the one hand and a new period of recession on the other. We know we have an economy which is dangerously reliant for growth on big infrastructure projects, which alone are not enough. So we need to plan for growth, a plan which demonstrates that Scotland is open for business. On tax, this isn't about ideology. It is simply about recognising the reality that we face. And the test for us when deciding whether to support or oppose this government will be whether we are helping or hindering growth. We will call out short-sighted fixes or tax raids born of envy rather than common sense. We will oppose the government's planned increases in business rates on many firms across Scotland, a plan which is still awaiting justification in any way at all. And we will propose, as well as oppose, with evidence-based policy to show how a competitive system of taxation in Scotland can benefit us all. Quite simply, we must give people and firms reasons for starting here, for settling here, and for growing their businesses here. Now, I'm aware that the Scottish Government will face pressure to do the opposite. Indeed, I read already that the three amigos leading the Greens, Labour and the Lib Dems are ganging up to form a new high-tax alliance. But I just remind my Labour and Lib Dem friends that it was this positive, forward-looking vision for Scotland of hitting hard-working people in the pockets which saw them lose 13 seats between them earlier this month. If you want to keep charging up the valley of death, please be my guest. But to the Scottish Government, I say, in all seriousness, there is no long-term future in a policy direction which will only suck enterprise out of Scotland. We need to support and encourage our businesses, not hobble them by imposing levies, by doubling supplements and by increasing rate rises. Now, of course, it's not just through tax that the Scottish Government can boost the economy. There is so much more besides, and there's two areas in particular which will be a priority for us. We will press the Scottish Government to encourage a new house-building revolution for Scotland. With better regulations, a streamlined planning system and improved infrastructure, we should aim to build 100,000 new homes over the coming 5 years, half of them affordable. So I welcome the First Minister's commitment to 50,000 affordable homes over the next Parliament, and we will hold her to that. And secondly, with the Scottish Government's capital budget rocketing over the coming years, let's see that put to good use. We will press for a transformative investment in energy efficiency, and we will call for £1 billion to be invested in our Warm Homes proposals, not just to cut bills and to reduce emissions, as important as each of these are, but to help the mental, the physical and the respiratory health of home dwellers and to create thousands of new jobs as well. The money is there. The Scottish Government has previously said that energy efficiency is a national infrastructure priority. And today we're told of a Warm Homes Bill. But up to now, they've shown no plans and allocated little budget on actually making it so. So we say put your money where your mouth is. Make energy efficiency a proper national infrastructure priority. 65% of all homes and 80% of rural properties have an EPC rating of D or worse. Invest in bringing those homes up to scratch. Allocate 10% of the capital budget by the end of the Parliament. Reduce fuel poverty. Start actually hitting some of this Parliament's environmental targets. Create a warmer, healthier Scotland and see thousands more people employed. And that employment spread right across the country, even to the most remote areas. I was going to say, before members and the government start protesting about a lack of funding, but I see they've already started, I suggest they first examine whether their own government is spending its own money wisely. Last week, we learned the full scale of the government's failure to deliver the CAP programme. Hundreds of millions of pounds ripped out of our rural economy. We are now lumbered with a programme costing nearly £200 million, which will deliver less for more, which could soon run out of money and which may land us with financial penalties from the EU of up to £125 million. It is a scandal and it has severely damaged this government's claim to competence. I, for one, don't think families in Scotland should have to pay higher taxes to pay for that. And I, for one, want to see this Scottish government clear up a mess which is entirely of its own making and for which it should be utterly ashamed. But the economy and wealth creation is only one side of the equation. Public services and the provisions by government lie on the other. On the health service, as we said in our manifesto, we will support financial protections for our NHS. We will join with others in backing significant increases in mental health services because we know that this will have huge benefits in the long term. Our new health team will also seek to work constructively with the Scottish Government and find consensus where appropriate. We know too that a functioning healthy society doesn't come simply by investing in a good quality NHS to treat those who are ill. It only comes if we think more broadly about health. So we will support greater integration between health and social care. It is the same person who needs help with adaptive housing and help with illness. We won't see the new welfare powers used to encourage people back into jobs with a target to halve the disability employment gap. And we will back and support measures in our prisons to cut reoffending with a review of all purposeful activity so that more released criminals are freed not just from jail, but also from the cycle of crime. And finally, I wish to turn to education. I welcome the First Minister's focus on this in her speech, and indeed, it is a good step forward that she wants to be judged on her performance. As I said at the start of today, this is the time for concerted action, and it is now time for all of us to be bold in our thinking. Too often, we as a nation have hidden from the hard facts with self-satisfied claims about how great Scotland's education system was in the past. And however true that once was, we cannot afford to allow ourselves to do so now. Not when standards in maths are tumbling, not when there's a lower proportion of children in primary reading well, and not when the numbers of secondary pupils who feel they belong to their school has fallen since the turn of the century. We should, as a parliament, agree that the status quo is no longer an option. This is not about left versus right. It is about focusing on what works and on having the courage to challenge and to change where necessary. So let me set out today what I think are the priorities. We all now agree across this chamber on the vital role played by early years education. A statistic we have heard too often in the last few months is that at age 5, a child whose parents have no qualifications is often already 18 months behind the vocabulary of a child whose parents are degree educated. The Scottish Government has proposed offering 30 hours of childcare a week, which is welcome. We will, however, propose that instead of offering this for mostly 3- and 4-year-olds, more should be allocated to children aged 1 and 2, particularly those from deprived communities. Let's take action to stop the attainment gap at the point at which it starts. In the state school sector, we will urge genuine reform. As the OECD report into Scottish education made clear earlier this year, curriculum for excellence is at a watershed. The report concluded we must now give strong leaders in schools and in local communities the chance to deliver it successfully. So our simple principle will be to demand that more power and control is driven down to where it belongs, and that is among school communities. It seems that in this area there is some consensus, and I have to say that we were flattered during the election campaign to find so many Scottish Conservative ideas published in January were repackaged in the SNP manifesto in April. We on these benches will use influence to ensure that these ideas come to fruition. And we welcome today's announcement of a summit on school reform, and I take this opportunity, Presiding Officer, to confirm my attendance and that of my education team. The government says that local school communities should have more say over education, and we agree. The government now also says that it supports the creation of so-called school clusters with their own governing bodies. And again, we agree here too. These are already being trialled in some parts of Scotland, and they are the right approach. Let's be clear at what the aim is. It is to give strong school leaders the chance to coordinate and run their local school communities, because that's how great schools are created. But where we will oppose the government is on any attempt to further centralise the control over education. The new Education Secretary must resist the temptation of assuming that he can improve things by ensuring he controls all of the levers in Edinburgh. Whether through a National Education Service or a series of yet more quangos overseeing schools, we believe this is the wrong step. Instead, this SNP government would be better served by spreading a little independence around our education sector. And while he's at it, I urge the new Education Secretary to reinstate Scotland in some of the international surveys we no longer take part in and reverse his predecessor's mistakes. Now, when it comes to higher education funding, I got the distinct impression from the election campaign that I may not get much change from the SNP on my ideas here. I do say this, however. Slap yourselves on the back about the benefits of free university education if you must. But remember that it comes at the cost of slapping further education colleges in the face. It's also seen poorer Scots less able to even walk through the front gate of a university than if they lived anywhere else in the UK. Education should be the best way to change lives for the better, but the SNP's middle-class giveaways means that those who've most to gain from life-changing chances are those that have been most harmed by this government's policies. We on these benches will continue to push for more funding for further education colleges over the course of this parliament to reverse the SNP's cuts in the last one. The further education sector has for too long been treated as a second-class service in post-16 education, and we will pressure the Scottish Government to put in place a comprehensive plan to increase spending. And lastly, Presiding Officer, since this too is now in the Education Secretary's brief, we will continue to press him to rethink the deeply flawed named person scheme before it is too late. We all have honest disagreements about the rights and wrongs of the scheme, of where focus should lie and where resource should be targeted. But I simply warn the SNP that it is now becoming increasingly clear that the statutory scheme that they are proposing is unworkable. Does the First Minister really want to press ahead with a scheme which is putting people off applying for primary school head teacher posts, as the leader of Aberdeen Council says it is? That, according to many health visitors, will wreck the trust between them and the families they visit? That has lost the support of more than half the populace of this country? There is a growing consensus in this Parliament that if the policy is not revoked altogether, there should at least be a pause. And I urge the SNP government to consider that and to rethink this chaotic plan immediately. So, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, opposition where necessary, proposing where required. This is the strong opposition that these benches will offer over the coming 5 years, and with a clear goal in mind, to ensure that Scotland gets the better government that we deserve and which will make a lasting difference to our nation's future. The Constitution will, I know, always be a constant driving force behind the SNP's agenda. I had hoped we might be able to get through an entire Sturgeon speech without it being mentioned, but sadly, the First Minister proved me wrong once again. However, I would gently say this to the First Minister and to her whole team. With our schools in need of reform, with a healthcare system to protect, with an IT shambles to sort out and a new tax and welfare system to run, I do suggest respectfully to the SNP benches that there is more than enough to be getting on with. The Parliament that decided whether or not to leave the UK is over. In this Parliament, let's get on with leading within the UK instead. Thank you.
Thank Ms Davison. And I call on Kezia Dugdale to be forward, followed by Patrick Harvey. Ms Dugdale.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today we have seen the SNP government take their first steps towards setting out a programme for government for this session. As the government sets out their priorities, I want to see a programme underlined by boldness and ambition. This is going to be a Scottish Parliament and a Scottish government like none that we have seen before. More powerful, with reach into even more areas of our lives, and the potential to meet the aspirations of all those across Scotland who want to build a fairer country for all. And in this task, Presiding Officer, the people of Scotland have matched the government with a Parliament that contains an opposition majority. When the First Minister sets her priorities, she can either look to the parties of the right or progressive parties of the left for support. So here are Labour's priorities: protecting our environment and our climate, and not opening Scotland up to fracking, another fossil fuel our environment cannot cope with and local people do not want. Preparing our NHS for the future and making sure that people can access services near where they live and when they need them, protecting local services from cutbacks. Restoring faith in our police service by investing in hard-working officers and staff, strengthening the relationship between the police and the communities that they serve. Giving everyone, regardless of their background or where in the country they live, access to Scotland's world-beating heritage, arts and culture. Protecting the BBC and building the infrastructure to grow our creative industries, because investment in creativity is investment in the future of our economy. My priority is to concentrate on the here and now, using the powers we have, instead of rerunning the arguments of the past. So that's why these benches will continue to argue for investment in our public services, why we'd continue to ask people to pay a little more so that we don't have to ask the poorest to cope with even greater cuts to the services that they rely on, and why we'd ask the richest 1% to pay their fair share so that we can educate our young people and prepare them for the future. And can I say to the Chamber, that is not a tax grab. That is not the politics of envy in Ruth Davidson's words. That is a question of fairness. It is an economic necessity. These are honest priorities that focus on the challenges we face as a nation. and they are backed up by commitments that demonstrate that we know how to pay for them. And we have said how we will pay for all our priorities, and as a responsible opposition, that is what people would expect from us. In a parliament, 400 miles from here, the SNP MPs have tabled an amendment to the Queen's speech. From opposition there, they call for an end to austerity and for investment in public services. Meanwhile, SNP members sit on the government benches in this parliament with the power to act, the power to stop the cuts, to invest in education, and they refuse to do so. It is cynicism of the worst kind. It is a dereliction of the duty they owe to some of the most disadvantaged people in this country, and these benches will not shy away from reminding the SNP of that each and every day. The question must also be asked as to why it has taken 9 years for the SNP to make education their priority. There is no greater priority for Scotland and for this Parliament than education. Whether it is the pursuit of a fairer, more socially just Scotland, or a Scotland more at peace and at ease with itself, or a wealthier and more prosperous Scotland, then education is the path, the door, and the key. So I agree with the First Minister when she says the future of this country does not lie with low-skilled, poorly paid jobs. It lies in the growth sectors like engineering and computing, with knowledge at their heart. It lies in the design, development and deployment of technologies, in jobs and professions we have not yet even thought of. It was David Bowie who said that tomorrow belongs to those who can hear it coming. Just before Christmas, I stepped into the future, also known as the Informatics Department at the University of Edinburgh. There, I met Baxter, a robot with the capacity and mobility to undertake many human tasks. Baxter and I built a battery pack. By using a pair of glasses that sensed my eye movement, Baxter could pass me tools and follow my instructions. Baxter represents both an opportunity and a threat. The boundless possibility of science combined with the loss of manual labour jobs. He represents a future where existing jobs are redundant and those set to replace them are still to be discovered. If we are not ready for this, we will be left behind. So I am with the First Minister when she says education is our top priority. And as I said last week, I am pleased to see John Swinney in the critical role of Education Secretary. However, if the SNP accept that investing in education, in skills, in science, in technology is the route to growing Scotland's economy, then John Swinney will need to be the first Education Secretary to convince the Finance Secretary not to cut the education budget. Because it was John Swinney's cuts which removed over 4,000 teachers from our schools and 152,000 students from our colleges. His were the financial constraints which see university staff on picket lines today and school teachers balloting to strike very soon. Over recent years, education and training budgets have been cut by 10%. Now, the First Minister had a lot to say about education today, but the one thing she didn't say was that she was going to protect the education budget. Now, that budget must be protected and enhanced, or we will indeed be left behind by other countries. There is no greater imperative for using the power of this Parliament to stop those cuts now and investing in taking this nation forward. It was JFK who said that our progress as a nation can be no swifter than our progress in education. The human mind is our fundamental resource. In Scotland, we understood this aphorism long before he coined it. We led the world in education, and our ambition should be no less than to do so again. That will not be achieved with tinkering with the governance of schools, nor by reintroducing a failed model of high-stakes testing, as the Tories propose. We will do it by beginning to increase teacher and nursery teacher numbers again, by making student support fit for purpose in both higher education and further education, and by closing the attainment gap between the richest and the rest, wherever poorer children live or go to school. We will do it by recognising that we have some of the best trained, best qualified and most professional teachers anywhere in the world. And we should be supporting them, not driving them to industrial action to get some sort of public hearing. We will do it by putting our colleges back where they belong, at the centre of an education system designed to realise the potential of everyone. And by everyone, we mean senior school students, second chance learners, women returners, or pretty much everyone who's going to find themselves retraining once or more than once during their working lifetime. We will do it by recognising that universities are about more than teaching undergraduates, but are also the drivers of innovation, of successful competition in global markets, and international partnership in the science which will shape this nation and our world. We can make a Scotland of that kind of imagination, innovation, exciting progressive vision, driving forward. Or we can continue to cut back on education budgets, close down avenues of advancement for our young people, drive our teachers and lecturers to the despair of industrial action. We can disrupt our schools for years through regionalisation, as this government did to colleges, kid ourselves that it is an efficiency drive, and avoid facing up to what our schools, colleges and universities really need. Presiding Officer, over the next 5 years of this Parliament, I look forward to working with the government when we agree and encourage them in the right direction when we do not. All of us in this chamber share a responsibility for building the fairer and more decent Scotland that we all want to see. And now every one of us holds even more power to do that in our own hands. So let's get to work. Thank you.
I thank Mr. Dugdale, and I call on Patrick Harvey to be followed by Willie Rennie. Mr. Harvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank the First Minister for the advance copy of her statement. I've said before, I think, that in this session of the Scottish Parliament, with a minority government, all political parties will need a positive agenda if we want to exercise influence in the Parliament. Simply laying implacable demands or seeking to block action, I don't think, will work. Greens will make positive proposals, and I think our track record in the previous session of minority government demonstrates that this approach can get results. The Scottish National Party may come to feel naturally entitled to propose its programme, but without a majority, it will need to convince, it will need to compromise, and it will need to be willing to give ground. I welcome some early signals that that approach is going to be taken today, and in particular, the commitment to increase the carers' allowance and to look at the Green policy proposal of an additional young carers' allowance. That's very welcome. And I also welcome the wider comment the First Minister made about social security. The chance, she said, to develop a social security system which respects the dignity of individuals as human beings. We must take every opportunity that we can in this Parliament to protect people from the UK government's damaging and divisive approach to the welfare system. And I very much welcome that the First Minister seems minded in that direction. The Green approach of being constructive and challenging will continue, and there are certainly areas of agreement beyond that, not only on the provision for carers, but other aspects of the approach to supporting children. I love the baby box idea. I wish we'd put that in our manifesto, I have to be honest. I would like to see an assurance from the First Minister that that won't involve any hint of corporate sponsorship. I'm very pleased to see that the First Minister is nodding in immediate response to that. Also, the important need to support maternity and early years allowances. That's another area, and top up to child benefit, I hope, is another area where we'll see some cross-party consensus, as well as on childcare. And I'm glad that there's recognition of the need for flexibility and quality of childcare, not just numbers of hours. On participatory budgeting, I'm very glad that the First Minister likes the idea of participatory budgeting. Green councillors have been champions of that at local level. But the idea of a nationally determined approach being imposed on all local councils does jar somewhat with the idea of participation. Are local elected councillors to be the only people not to be allowed their own say about local spending levels? Participatory budgeting is a good thing, and we'll continue to back it. But it should be in the context of a more economically empowered local democracy, where councils can make meaningful choices instead of just jumping through hoops set by national government. That's why we'll continue to make the case for the scrapping of the council tax and its replacement in this session of Parliament with a modern alternative, and for more widely renewing local democracy in Scotland. There are other aspects of the statement which should get broad support consensus between the parties. Commitment to the rollout of broadband, increasing apprenticeships and overcoming gender inequality. And the Warm Homes Bill. Who isn't proposing a Warm Homes Bill this year? Only a mere 13 years after Robin Harper first proposed one, I'm glad that it will finally happen. But it is going to have to come with the financial commitment to make it a reality. And on educational attainment, I think all parties have recognised that more can be achieved. But the case for standardised testing, I don't think, has been fully made, and we'll continue to question that choice of priorities. We'll welcome the opportunity to engage actively with the government's educational agenda, but we do remain concerned that the need to ensure that education remains democratically accountable through our local authorities is something which needs to be defended. And the commitment to maintaining free higher education with no front door or back door fees, that's something the Greens welcome wholeheartedly. But the notion that that policy comes at a cost to further education has persisted for too long. Both are vital to people, to communities, and to the country as a whole. I deprecate the presentation of that dichotomy by Ruth Davison, but very clearly, spending commitments are needed from the Scottish Government if we're going to protect both FE and HE. And finally, on making the case for independence, one which is clearly going to need a stronger and more pluralistic case than we've seen in 2014, Greens look forward to continuing to play a constructive role. There will be areas of clear disagreement which require discussion between all political parties. The Scottish Government's proposal to halve and then scrap air passenger duty, for example, there is clear parliamentary opposition to that proposal. But I come back to this notion that parties will be successful by proposing constructive alternatives. I'm convinced that an alternative to the SNP's policy here, one which meets an environmental test through reducing aviation emissions and a social justice test by not placing the burden only on those who fly once a year for an annual holiday, such an alternative can be developed. And we'll seek the government's agreement on that point of principle. For example, the idea of a frequent flyer levy is one that deserves examination. The opposition of some political parties to child protection legislation, which Parliament passed in the last session, has, in my view, been disgraceful. And the misrepresentation of those policies as though they undermine human rights or the rights of families, I think, is disgraceful. But I suspect there is support for proper, robust post-legislative scrutiny to ensure that the implementation can take place as intended. And I hope that's something where there will be agreement between opposition and government parties. And further, there will be areas where additional pressure is needed. Very clearly on the climate change targets, over the last few years, we've seen government use statistical anomalies to absolve themselves of responsibility for failing to meet the climate change targets. We're likely to see a further statistical anomaly make it easier for them to reach this year's climate change target, given changes to the European Emissions Trading Scheme. I hope that they won't take a different approach to the role that statistical anomalies play this year than last year, simply because it gives them a more convenient response. But clearly, there is a need for bolder action, and I'm glad the First Minister acknowledged there is a need for bolder action if we're going to go further and meet those climate change targets for the longer term. Finally, there must be a case made for a shift toward a progressive, sustainable transport policy, something which has been lacking for far too long. As for the wider Green case on a transition away from an economy desperately vulnerable to the oil and gas sector, yet more job losses announced today, do we really want Scotland to remain so vulnerable to a finite industry? Do we really want Scotland to remain vulnerable and overexposed to an industry which is doing so much damage to our world? one which clearly cannot last. How long should we remain so vulnerable? 5 years? 10 years? 20? The investment in an alternative is urgent. And there is much that we agree with in the First Minister's statement about that need for innovation. I would say that both in relation to the private sector, the public sector and the community sector. Innovation not only in new industries, but also in new business models, such as greater reliance on employee ownership, on social enterprise and on mutuals. But this innovation, this building of a new sustainable economy, has to be seen as an alternative to simply pretending that business as usual in fossil fuels can continue. And finally, Presiding Officer, Greens will continue to challenge the disconnect that exists between mindless measurements of economic growth and the notion of well-being, distribution and a healthy economy. Economies can grow while seeing social justice erode or be built up. Economies can grow while achieving environmental sustainability or continuing to deplete their finite natural resources. Growth is not the objective that this government should continue to commit to, but the health and well-being of our economy and the sustainability of our environment. Greens will continue to make that case.
Thank Mr. Harvey. And I call on Willie Rennie. Mr. Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank the First Minister for an advance copy of her statement. I noticed that Patrick Harvey is urgently, desperately looking for the closure of the North Sea oil industry tomorrow. He can't wait for 5-10 years. He wants to get on with it now. He hasn't learned any lessons about his economic policies. I think what is clear is that we have a choice in the next 5 years, a big choice. We can seek to be aspirational, ambitious, looking to bold solutions for the future, or we can hunt for security in timidity. And I think what we heard today from the First Minister was the latter. She's beginning to sound like Gordon Brown the more that she speaks. The double and the treble counting of all her sums of money. I'm sure she'll add the letter S onto the end of everything, whether it's billions rather than billion. It'll be trebling the money that we've got. It won't make it any more unless she pays for more. The reality is she needs to focus on the big challenges that we face. And she's also hunting for things like plans, advisors, councils of advisors, consultations, summits, anything but action to make a change for the future of our country. I think we need to choose bold, ambitious options rather than the timidity that we have seen from the SNP statement today. I think also we need to recognise that the SNP have lost their majority. You wouldn't think it from the statement that was made. I think it's clear we need to recognise that, and that the SNP need to reach out across the chamber, and it would need more than a couple of references to policies from other parties. I'm pleased that the SNP have agreed to have a dedicated mental health minister, but it will take more than that to convince us of the SNP's programme. I'm pleased they've adopted and have picked out some things from the Green Manifesto and the Labour Manifesto, but it will take more than that for the SNP to be ambitious for our country. So recognise that the SNP have lost their majority. And I just say simply to the Conservatives, I congratulate them for their growth in numbers, but they weren't elected for being Conservatives. That's not why they were elected. They were elected for not being the SNP. Now, that does therefore not mean that they have got an endorsement of every Conservative policy that has been proposed. That is quite clear. So I want Scotland to be ambitious. I want our country to be ambitious for our future. And let's begin on an area where we can perhaps agree about the future. Let's look at mental health. Mental health services have diminished under the SNP over the last 9 years. They've taken a step back. We used to have a world-leading mental health strategy. We don't even have one anymore. The former mental health minister's sitting in front of me here. I'm sure he's rather embarrassed by the fact that he didn't get it renewed. We also have got so many people waiting for so long for urgent treatment. And that's because the SNP have reduced the proportion of mental health spending as a proportion of NHS spending. The NHS has not put enough money into mental health services, and that therefore needs to change. So we need more than just the minister. We need the funds to go with it for emergency support in primary care, but also for child and adolescent mental health services. There are no beds north of Dundee for children and adolescents. There needs to be beds north of Dundee. The whole country doesn't just live in the central belt. There are people in far-flung parts of our country that deserve the support of mental health services. That is something the SNP will be judged on in the next 5 years. The second area they will be judged on is GPs. And we didn't get any reference at all to GPs in the statement earlier. She did not admit we are 740 short. 740 short by the end of the decade. And again, the reason for this is simple. Apart from the lack of planning from the SNP government, the proportion of money that has been spent on GP services has fallen under the SNP. So let them recognise that too. They will be judged on that too. No mention of the intrusive super ID database. I wonder if that's been quietly ditched now that John Swinney has been moved to a new department. I think we need some clarity as to whether they have plans for that for the future. So there are areas of cooperation, but I sense from the reaction from these benches that they're not up for any cooperation. So let's focus on education. Now, Nicola Sturgeon said, we must never talk down what we have. I celebrate what we have, but let's not be deluded about what we have. The OECD were clear. The OECD were clear. They're getting very animated, Presiding Officer. I wonder why that is. They're getting animated because we're getting to the heart of the problems of the SNP government. Scotland used to have one of the best education systems in the world. Now it's been judged as just average. The party that claims to be Scotland's party has dragged down our education system to just average. And they think by some regional boards for the running of education, for some national testing, that will suddenly turn everything around. Unless you put the resources in, you won't make the difference. That's why the SNP need to recognise they will need more resources if we are going to get Scottish education back up to being the best in the world again. And I've got one suggestion, one practical suggestion that the SNP may want to look at with their new shiny Council of International, not just national, but international education advisers. Will they look at the proposals from Upstart? Upstart is an organisation that's looking to raise the starting school age to 7. I think that is something that has got merit. So if the SNP are really looking to reach out and to reach for new opportunities to get our education system being the best again, they would look at that proposal. But I was interested to see during the election that after many, many months of opposition to the proposal of a pupil premium, that it has been embraced by the SNP manifesto. I wonder what happened between Angela Constance uttering her opposition to the proposal and to the SNP manifesto writers putting it down into print. But there is no good just having the name of a pupil premium unless it's properly resourced. So we don't need timid SNP amounts of funds for the pupil premium. We need proper resources. And my final plea is to the SNP to make sure we implement the early years offer properly. We need to make sure that we don't have the record of the last few years where only 7% of two-year-olds get the nursery education they were entitled to when 27% should have got it. So let's get on with the job, making sure that Scotland is bold and ambitious with these range of policies. We won't make Scotland the best again with a timidity from the SNP. We need bold policies to make that difference. Thank you.
Thank Mr. Rennie. And we now... Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We now move to the open debate. Before I call Mr. Crawford, can I just remind members, this is a debate. Members are free to interject or intervene at any stage. You simply stand up and catch my eye or the Speaker's eye to take your intervention. And Mr. Swinney should know that before becoming increasingly animated. This is also an unusual debate in that it runs over 2 days, but with many of the occasions over the next few days, several of the new members will be making their first speeches. And it has become custom over the last few years not to interject or intervene on first speeches. That is entirely up to members, but that has become custom. I would also make one final point in that although this debate runs over 2 days, any member who has participated or has spoken in the debate is expected to be here for the closing remarks, which will be tomorrow afternoon. I now call on Bruce Crawford to be followed by Maurice Golden. Mr. Crawford.
Thank you, President Officer. Let me begin my personal congratulations to you and your new deputies in your new role. I know you will do yourselves and this Parliament proud. I also want to extend my congratulations to all the new MSPs that have not yet had the opportunity to greet personally on your election to this place. However, we would not have to be elected to this Parliament to know that issues such as the health of our nation and the education of our young people are well fought over political battlegrounds. Some of that discourse has rightly been about holding the governments of the day to account, but much of it has also seen the issues of health and education weaponised for narrow political gain to an unhelpful degree. That being said, I believe we now have a window of opportunity to lay aside partisan political positioning and build a national consensus on matters of vital importance to the future of our nation. With a balanced parliament, a third of the MSPs new to this place, and no national parliamentary elections in the offing for 4 years. This is an opportunity we must grasp to build as much as consensus as can be achieved. Now, of course, with a balanced parliament and a minority government will not in itself ensure that consensus will be reached. It will need to be worked at, and worked at hard, without, of course, as the First Minister rightly says, allowing inertia to set in. It will require government that's prepared to seek common ground and build alliances both inside this place and out with. But it will also require an opposition prepared to be positive and responsible, and the knowledge that not only can they win the arguments, but they can also win the votes and make real gains on behalf of the people they represent. Therefore, minority government should not become a test of a government's ability to win votes, but a test on whether the Parliament can find agreement. I believe our respective manifesto commitments, together with the many words spoken about the central importance of education and National Health Service to our national life during the campaign, provides fertile ground on which to plant the seeds of consensus in order to grow agreement on the way forward. I know that from an SNP government perspective, the First Minister and her government are ready and willing to try and find common ground on how best to transform our public services. Now, during the cut and thrust of any campaign, issues are highlighted and there's sharp focus on people's priorities and the message they give us on the doorsteps. It's our job as members of the Scottish Parliament to bring these issues alive on behalf of the people we represent in our respective constituencies. And during my contribution today, I want to highlight just a couple of areas that people I met during the campaign would expect me to raise as part of this debate today. And let me begin with the National Health Service. So my enduring memory of the campaign was that people recognised that all political parties were prepared to commit additional expenditure to our most cherished public service, albeit some parties were prepared to commit more financial resources than others. But to dwell on this would be actually to miss the point of what people were telling me. Yes, recognition that more money than ever before was to be spent, but a clear understanding also existed that we cannot go on delivering a level of service people expect without fundamental change in both the way the service is delivered and the structure of delivery. That's why I strongly support the aim in the SNP manifesto to review the number, structure and regulation of health boards and the relationship with local government. If we are going to secure the integrity of the National Health Service for the next decade and beyond, we must be courageous in our ambition to reduce backroom duplication and structural impediments to the provision of improved care. All parties in this chamber and each individual MSP, I believe, share the ambition for Scotland to be one of the top performing countries in the world when it comes to education and the lifelong learning of our people. But to be able to achieve such an ambition will require a transformation not just in how we deliver childcare and education for our young people, but also in how we do politics. If we're truly serious about this national ambition, we need to fully release the ideas, the energy and commitment of parents and professionals and others alike. This simply will not happen if education continues to be a bickering ground on politics focused on narrow party advantage. Certainly.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. I'm interested in what he has just said about engagement with parents. Could he spell out in a little bit more detail exactly the plans that the SNP have to do this?
When I'm talking about parents in that regard, what we can't do, I would say to Elizabeth Smith, is involve ourselves in a bickering exercise over how we take forward education. No. Otherwise, we will lose these parents on the journey to make the improvements we need to make in our country. And it's for that reason I was so pleased that the First Minister appointed John Swinney to be our Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, with a remit that also includes coordination of public sector reform across government. I've known John Swinney well for many years. I've worked closely with him in government. He's the right person in the government to do this most vital of jobs. I know he'll do what is right for the young people of Scotland, and I sincerely hope the opposition spokespeople are capable of working constructively with him. You know, chances like this don't come along very often, and the people of Scotland will not forget nor forgive those who jeopardise our young people's future for political advantage. Now, I have a lot more to say, but in conclusion, because I've only got 6 minutes, I look forward to the next 5 years with a renewed belief and confidence that if we work together, we can make Scotland stronger, and I commend the government to you.
Speeches should be up to 6 minutes. I call Maurice Golden to be followed by Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today I will bring the circular economy to the heart of the debate around the environment and climate change. I say this because I have a career defined by economics and the environment. My undergraduate degree was in economics, and I've done a master's in environmental law. I've worked as part of this agenda internationally in Europe and in Australia, and I've also previously worked for Keep Scotland Beautiful, for Ofgem, as well as for Zero Waste Scotland, and I refer members to the Register of Interests with respect to Zero Waste Scotland. But before I speak more about the circular economy, can I first say what an honour and privilege it is to represent the people of the West of Scotland, and I pledge to represent their views in Parliament. I'd also like to pay tribute to my predecessor, Annabel, now Baroness Goldie, and her support over the past 15 years in my quest for elected office. Certainly the highlight must be Golden, Goldie and Golden Eagle during the Glenrothes by-election, and that just goes to show that PR stunts weren't just the vestige of the last Scottish parliamentary campaign, Willie Rennie. Secondly, I would like to commend the First Minister on her decision to separate the ministries, which gives added impetus to the environmental agenda. Moreover, I'd like to congratulate Rosanna Cunningham on her appointment as Cabinet Secretary. I know she brings a wealth of experience and expertise to the role. Finally, can I recognise the contribution of Richard Lockhead for his stewardship of the environmental brief, not rural affairs, and the way in which Scotland has been positioned as a leader in environment and climate change. Now, unfortunately, those words aren't backed up by action. The Scottish Government has failed to meet its own climate change targets. It has failed to meet its own recycling rate targets, and it's failed in terms of a coordinated approach with public sector bodies and agencies. This Parliament has the opportunity to be better, to be bolder, and to deliver for Scotland. For the Scottish Conservatives, the circular economy is an economic system where products, materials, and resources are used for as long as possible in order to extract the maximum value from them. In this way, and in the longer term, it is a win for the environment, a win for consumers, and a win for business. Globally, we are using 1.5 times the amount of resources which we can make available. And this trend is set to increase as middle classes increase, as consumerism increases, and as urbanisation increases. Scottish businesses will struggle with the long-term increase in the price of commodities, as well as price shocks, unless we can better control supply chains and recover materials. Globally and locally, we are seeing the impact of climate change in droughts, in flooding, and in deforestation. We also have a global problem with mining, where to produce this 500-gram mobile phone, 75 kilograms of waste is produced. And there's so much more we can do to realise the massive potential benefits for Scotland. Ellen MacArthur, who's a pioneer of the circular economy, she developed the concept while she was sailing solo around the world in 72 days, beating Phileas Fogg and the world record at the same time. And as part of that journey, she had to take everything she required with her on that trip. And that got her thinking about applying that concept to nations. She subsequently set up the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, and that same foundation has said that by following circular economy policies, the value to Scotland could be £3 billion. Moreover, a recent report by Green Alliance has estimated that there are 20,000 new jobs that could be created by 2030 by following these policies. These jobs are more sustainable, they help tackle unemployment, and they are resilient to any hollowing out of the labour market. Sorry, Kezia. These jobs are reliant on recycling, on servitisation, on the selling of services rather than products, on remanufacturing, on reuse, and on biorefining. And note, no mention of incineration. I'd like to close by a personal invitation to help with climate change. And firstly, you may not be aware, but my old adversary in Cunningham North, Kenneth Gibson, MSP, cannot ride a bike. So therefore, he's forced to drive or take public transport. Having recently taught my daughter to ride a bike, I'd like to extend the invitation to Kenneth, but I warn him, no back chat. Secondly, Kenneth Gibson, presiding officer, I would like to offer to car share with him from our homes in Eastwood, but I'll ask him not to sing along to the radio. My final thought is that for this Parliament, we can be bolder, we can be better in order to deliver a circular economy for Scotland. Thank you.
Richard Leonard, followed by Joan McAlpin.
Deputy Presiding Officer, thank you for calling me. This is my maiden speech, so I want to begin by thanking the people of Central Scotland who have put their faith in me and kept their faith in my party in this month's election. I also want to take this opportunity to pay tribute to the work of my predecessors, Siobhan McMahon and Margaret McCulloch, who are no longer members of this Parliament, but who gave 5 years of distinguished public service to the people of Central Scotland. Deputy Presiding Officer, I have come here to try and make a change, because I think that this Parliament is in danger of becoming complacent and indifferent. Complacent and indifferent, so that when it was revealed last week that we now have over 10,000 people on the unemployment claimant count in Central Scotland alone, the former Cabinet Secretary thinks it is good enough to issue a press release opining that, and I quote, our employment rate is the second highest in the four nations. What good is that? What comfort is that to the 21,500 women and men in Central Scotland, for that is the real number, according to the Labour Force survey, who are now out of work? That is an unacceptable level of employment, of unemployment, which isn't just an injustice for those 21,000 families facing grinding poverty and growing inequality, and it leads to 1 in 5 children being born into poverty in Scotland today. It is a stain on our society which diminishes us all. When James Keir Hardie, who was born 160 years ago in the area I now represent in this Parliament, when Keir Hardie gave his maiden parliamentary speech, he also spoke of the unemployment question, which he described as, and I quote, the moral degradation of enforced idleness. That is a phrase which I hope the new Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Jobs and Fair Work will remember. The moral degradation of enforced idleness. Keir Hardie also spoke in his maiden speech of industrial distress. And the truth is, we still have industrial distress today. Just ask the 450 workers at Shell's Aberdeen headquarters who have served notice of redundancy this morning. And I fear that this new Scottish government, like the old Scottish government, has no strategy for tackling it. No industrial policy, no manufacturing strategy, no joining together of public procurement with our industrial base, in short, no economic plan. We have more than ever an economic system which works for those who own the wealth rather than for those who, through their hard work and endeavour, create the wealth, or could create it given half the chance. And let me give you an example. Just this week, I visited the Tannow factory in Coatbridge. It has been there for 40 years. Yet a man called Uli Beringer, who bought it just 1 year ago, wants to close it down and move the work to Kidderminster and to China. It is a modern factory with a skilled workforce making a world-class product. This is precisely why we need a government which is prepared to act, not merely to send in a partnership action for continuing employment team, but a government prepared to actively intervene on the side of those gallant working women and men who, with their union, are in the fight of their lives to keep the work and the jobs here. So I call this afternoon on the Scottish Government to act decisively with the owner of Tannow and to act now. That's why I will also make it my job to remind the new Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Jobs and Fair Work of this, that democracy should be a central aim of economic policy too, that we should never, never accept the current levels of unemployment, and this needs to be tackled with a renewed sense of urgency. Tinkering with these problems will not work. We need an industrial policy which relies on more than private enterprise and the free market. We need a vision of a renewed Scotland, reindustrialisation and economic modernisation, investment in education, and yes, the principled readoption of full employment as a goal of public policy. And here are two final figures I'd also like the First Minister and the new Cabinet Secretary to consider when they are reviewing their priorities. In central Scotland alone, over 29,500 households are on council house waiting lists. Many of them families living in cramped, unsuitable accommodation. How can we expect, and I quote, to drive forward improvements in educational outcomes when too many school-aged children are condemned to live like this? We should put people back to work by building council houses and homes for social rent again. And we know as well that a half of our pensioners live in fuel poverty. A half of our pensioners cannot afford to keep warm. So let us start looking in this new Parliament at the new powers we have to see what we can do to improve the income of our pensioners who have served this society well. But let us also start using the old powers to put people back to work on a warm homes programme. Deputy Presiding Officer, there are Democrats in this Parliament who answer to the call of the nationalist bugle, and there are rather more of them than there are of us. But I am a democratic socialist. My worldview is different. My priorities for Scotland are different. This Parliament will be a battle of those different ideas. It is a battle which the newly elected members from my party, guided by our principles, determined by our values, with a renewed vision of the good society we want to build, it is a battle that we are relishing.
Joan McAlpin, followed by Gordon Lyndhurst.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start, Presiding Officer, by congratulating the previous two speakers, Richard Leonard and Maurice Golden, on their first speeches. I don't think we're allowed to say maiden speeches anymore. So congratulations on your first speeches, and I look forward to hearing your future contributions to the Chamber. The debate today is about how we can use the powers of this Parliament to improve the lives of everyone in the country. It's no secret that I do not think that these powers go far enough, but it is very clear that this government and this First Minister is absolutely focused on delivering with those powers. There's a wealth of commitment and ambition here, and we have not even unveiled a programme for government yet. The early years and attainment programmes in particular are very ambitious. A £500 million investment to double early learning in this Parliament to 30 hours a week. I think it's important to say that as well as benefiting parents and children, it's a huge infrastructure project which will benefit the economy as well and create jobs in every corner of Scotland, along with the increased hours of childcare. 60 new childcare centres will be created and more than 20,000 more qualified staff will be employed by 2021. And in response to some comments about access to further education to poorer young people, I would also draw attention to this government's commitment to extend educational maintenance allowance and remind our colleagues in the Conservative benches that, of course, educational maintenance allowance has been abolished by the Conservatives in England, affecting the poorest children in society there. The ambitious early years agenda is a great credit to the First Minister and to her government. And as is challenging the target of closing the attainment gap in education, something previous governments have not managed to achieve. This is not a new thing. And I'm particularly pleased that the manifesto has confirmed that money for schools will be allocated according to the number of children eligible for free school meals, not the index of multiple deprivation, which often doesn't work in rural areas. Finally, in response to on education, a number of other contributions from the opposition benches, I think, have been a little bit too gloomy. And I think we should remind ourselves that it was only 2 years ago that the Office of National Statistics published a report that showed us that Scotland is the best educated nation in the world, with 45% of people aged 25 to 64 having a tertiary education, with many having degrees. I mentioned rural areas with regards to education. I represent one of those rural areas, the south of Scotland, and I want to see that rural area benefiting from the government's economic programme and infrastructure ambitions, which I am pleased to see the First Minister's outlined today. It's been my view that one of the great achievements of SNP governments between 2007 and 2016 has been that we have managed to invest record amounts in infrastructure despite extremely sharp cuts to our capital spending budget from London. In my own region, Dumfries and Galloway, there have been a number of important upgrades to roads, and we are building a new hospital. And I'm very pleased that there's more coming and that there is an ambition to do more. And I was very pleased that in April, our Deputy First Minister, John Swinney, committed to chair a transport summit for Dumfries and Galloway to really raise the ambition to properly connect this region to the rest of Scotland. And that was something that I had included in my manifesto for Dumfries. Now, I hope now that Mr. Swinney has moved into education, if he's unable to chair that summit, that it can go ahead with Mr. Youssef in the chair. The town of Dumfries is the capital of the south of Scotland, but it doesn't have a dual road linking it to the motorway, and it doesn't have a direct rail connection, which is electrified. And similarly, the A75, a Euro route, is not dualled either in large stretches, and there is a high-profile campaign by local students in the region to upgrade it. And I hope that as part of our infrastructure investment over this Parliament outlined by the First Minister, we'll be able to address some of these long-standing issues affecting the southwest of Scotland that go far back beyond even the SNP government, indeed the Scottish Parliament. I'm very pleased that the FM has said that our government will carry out a review of the roles, responsibilities and relationships of our Enterprise Development and Skills Agency. I believe that this offers a real opportunity to the south of Scotland, where the Scottish Enterprise Business Gateway model has not always worked as well as elsewhere. And both as a regional member in the constituency and as a member of the Economy Committee in the last session of Parliament, it was clear to me that the way companies were selected for account management wasn't always working well in the South because we didn't have the size of companies required to qualify for the account management, and that means that you didn't get the support. While Scottish Enterprise have, I know, made different internal decisions to try to address these problems, I do think that in the course of this review that the First Minister talked about, we should look at ways of bringing in elements of Highland and Island Enterprise, which is a community development remit, into the highly rural south of Scotland so that we can address some of the particular challenges facing the area. Now, the First Minister made an extremely wide-ranging speech, and it's absolutely impossible to cover everything that she talked about. But what did strike me about it was the way that it contrasted...
Would you wind up, please, Ms. McAlpin?
The way that it contrasted with some other elements of people in the opposing benches that talk incessantly about constitutional matters. The First Minister, I think, allocated just less than a minute to constitutional matters. Nobody has the right to stop
Scotland's
people determining their own future. But we are focused on the powers that the Parliament has now, and I welcome the priorities that the First Minister has outlined.
I have Gordon Lyndhurst, followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. When I was a boy in the dim and distant 1970s, I remember how easy it was to contact people. My mother's parents, who lived in Ayrshire, didn't have a telephone in those days. So when my mother wanted to speak to my gran, and she would phone my gran's neighbour first and tell the neighbour when she would phone back. The neighbours were called the Browns, and either Mr. or Mrs. Brown would then cross the road to my grand's and tell them when my mother would be phoning. If it worked, all was well. If it didn't, the procedure just repeated itself until my mum got my gran at the neighbours. In those days of no internet, no emails, no mobile phones, and dare I say it, no Scottish Parliament, this was an accepted way of life. Inconceivable in modern Scotland. Scotland today benefits from the great technological advances of the preceding decades. This Parliament will be, we hope, an example of modern Scotland working at its best with the benefit of cutting-edge technology. But not only new institutions like this Parliament have benefited. The Faculty of Advocates, an ancient institution from which I come to this more modern institution, has adapted to make full use of modern technology. The National Library of Scotland has likewise done so, and I hope it's not like a speech at a wedding where by naming two I offend any others by leaving them out. These are meant to simply be representatives of what we have in this great country of ours. We have progressed far, but there remains much, much more to be done. Broadband access is no longer a luxury, but an essential for any business or organization to operate effectively. For today's generation of young people, internet access is considered to be as essential to life as bread and water, or so they tell me. I'm very pleased that this is recognized by the party to which I belong. I'm pleased that the need for further progress in this area is considered a priority. I'm not going to go into detail on our party policies in this area. I leave that to my colleagues who have been given that brief in the Shadow Cabinet. And may I say, I look forward, along with my other colleagues, to working together with those who have been appointed to the Shadow Cabinet by our leader. But of course, we hope that all MSPs will be willing to work together for the good of Scotland. On a personal note, may I say that it was a woman who first encouraged me in my interest in politics. No, First Minister, not you, I'm afraid, but rather my own mother. Now, not to forget my father, who interested me in literature in spite of its consequences for him. My mother, a good Ayrshire woman, knew her Burns and turned it to advantage when there were disagreements in the family household. Her most telling line in any disagreement with my father was the words, "O add some power, the gift he gave us, to see yourselves as others see us." With that, my father knew the argument was lost, shrugged his shoulders, and there we are, he would say. Sadly, neither of them are with us this side of heaven to hear me pay this glowing tribute to their, in my experience, virtually unique way of settling arguments. We all know how much things have changed since the new Scottish Parliament started in 1999. At the same time, people have not changed. And the country that we have, the people that we represent, are in many ways the same. The constituency I stood for in this election, Edinburgh Pentlands, is in many ways a diverse example, not just of Edinburgh and the Lothians, but of Scotland itself. From small communities like Kingsnow, with its own railway station, to world-class universities such as Heriot Watt. From local volunteers at the Gala Day in Balerno to the Whale Arts Centre in Wester Hales. The churches of Fairmile Head and Juniper Green, Dreghorn Barracks, the shops of Collinton Village, Pentlands Community Centre in Oxgangs, to Curry Primary School, to mention but a few. All of these and many, many more make up who and what we are in Scotland and what we are about. No doubt we are all glad to have the election campaign behind us, at least I think most of us are. We are also ready to get to work. But before leaving the election behind, I would like to thank all who worked so hard and voted to see myself and others elected. And I'm sure that all of us have memories that we take with us from the election campaign and from election day itself. One of mine from the election day is standing outside the polling station at St. Fillan's Church in Buxton. A young family came out of the polling station, the two young boys in their school uniforms wanting to shake my hand as a candidate. Their parents had taken them with them to vote, to give them an opportunity to see democracy in action. I shook their hands, and their little sister, not wanting to be left out, wanted to shake my hand too. She wanted to be part of it. This is what democracy is about. This is why we are here. We are here because we have been entrusted with taking Scotland forward. For the young people who were too young to vote to choose us, for their future, and for those who did choose us, for their present. Let us act together not just to make Scotland better, but to make it the best it can be.
George Adam, followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I firstly congratulate yourself and your colleagues, Presiding Officer, on your elevation to the role that you currently have. And also, can I congratulate many of the first-time speakers here today? It was only 5 years ago where I was able to wax lyrically about Paisley on that one occasion. And it's something that you can do and obviously enjoy at that point. But it's good to be back, Presiding Officer, and it's good to get back to business again, the important business, and to say that we've got this new positivity, this new balanced Parliament, as my colleague Bruce Crawford said. And I think he's right when he says these are wise words from Bruce Crawford when he said that we have to sit back and we have to look at the opportunity that we have here to work together to create the type of future that we all want to do. And I think it's good to see that that positivity has been brought through by many of the opposition members. Well, a guy can actually dream, you know. Maybe it wasn't quite as positive as that. But I think we have to find this way of working because that's what the people of Scotland have decided and that's what's been elected in this Parliament. And we have to make sure that we work together for that future. But, Presiding Officer, it hardly feels like 5 years since I was originally elected as Paisley's MSP. An election night for me this year wasn't quite as nerve-wracking as back in 2011, with a majority of 5,199, as opposed to 248. But it's once again an honour to represent the great town of Paisley for another 5 years. And although challenging, it's a challenge that I look forward to, because you may or may not have noticed that I'm extremely proud of my hometown and the people I represent. And I may have mentioned that on more than one occasion in the past. But last term, I had the honour to serve on the Education and Culture Committee. And it was during that term that the First Minister announced that educational attainment gap, and bridging the educational attainment gap was meant to be the work that we would be concentrating on. And I think it's something that we have to really take seriously and work with each other on, because for far too long in constituencies like mine and others throughout the whole of Scotland, there has been a deciding factor in where you live has decided where you actually end up in your educational career, and that cannot go on any longer. In my own area, you've Fergusley Park, that has areas of deprivation in it, and Ralston in the east end, which is actually an affluent area. And when you look at the differences in people's lives and how they can actually, their outcomes, when you see that difference, we should not be living in a country that no child should have to actually be decided their future on the fact that they come from a certain area. We need to find a way why that young men and these young women end up disengaging with education as they hit teenage years, why they move away from that in our poorer areas, because I think the First Minister is correct when one of the solutions to this is rooted in the early years. I'm pleased to hear the First Minister say today that ensuring equality of opportunity for young people starts well before the school years and extends from beyond the school gate. I think that sums up this whole debate when we're talking about educational attainment. Because before many children get to the school gate, their educational future has been decided because of their parents' situation and what's happened with them as well. So we need to work with these communities and all our communities to ensure that we can actually show that way forward. And it's welcomed that the Scottish Government intends to invest a further £750 million over the life of this Parliament to close the educational attainment gap, targeting where it is needed and controlled by head teachers, not administrators in other buildings far away from education. And the targeting can come from the National Improvement Framework, which helps towards finding out where the support is needed, making sure that funding goes to the right place and making sure the help is in the right place at the right time. Ensuring we create a culture of learning that helps our children and young people. You know, I can declare an interest at this point, Presiding Officer, because I'm already a grandparent with Daisy. My daughter's pregnant again. She's determined to make me have lots of grandchildren at a very young age, which seems like a good idea. But that is, we're all in a similar boat, whether it's children or whether it's the grandchildren. We all want the best for our children to ensure that they get that opportunity regardless of where they live. And as I mentioned earlier, Presiding Officer, it does start in the early years. And obviously raising the attainment starts with the youngest, and it's the highest quality of childcare. And I'm glad that we have appointed a minister whose whole point is to actually make sure that we deliver that level of childcare in Mark MacDonald. And our youngest people can get the help that they need. But during this Parliament, the government has already will commit £500 million to nearly double early learning and childcare to 30 hours a week. Now, that shows you that we are committed to actually make this investment. This isn't the times of massive capital projects where you see a bridge over a stretch of water or a massive road. This is an infrastructure project that's making difference in our communities, in the very heart of our communities, almost invisible, but making that massive difference to people's lives as well. So I would say that, Presiding Officer, in the coming 5 years, I'm tasking myself to address the challenges of educational attainment, and I will work with anyone who wants to do that as well. Anyone who wants to take up this challenge and work towards that, because first that I will continue to represent my constituents to the very best of my ability, making sure that they get the equality that they need in their lives. And the other reason, Presiding Officer, is Paisley is my hometown. It's my place in the world, and it's where my fellow buddies are from. I will work with everyone to make sure that we give them the equality and everything in life, and we can make this Parliament something that they will be proud of.
Rhoda Grant, followed by Jenny Gilruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I too congratulate new members making their first speeches. Presiding Officer, connectivity is not a luxury, it's a necessity. Scottish Labour led the charge for better connectivity, and we've continued to campaign for that over the last decade and to see that improvement through. And these campaigns have resulted in projects such as the Highlands and Islands programme being rolled out. And that was supposed to deliver 84% by the end of this current phase. And if you contrast that with the First Minister's assertion that over 85% of Scotland is currently covered, it shows you the difference between rural and urban coverage. The SNP have now been in power for 9 years. They promised 95% coverage by 2017, and there's not a hope of achieving that promise. And if you break those figures down geographically, you see a huge disparity with many rural areas much more less likely to be connected, and sometimes rates not even close to 50%. The Scotland-wide figures hide the real rural unmet need for connectivity. What we need is a strong strategy targeting those hard-to-reach areas. We know that BT, the preferred contractor, only operates through fibre and copper, but we need a mix of technologies to get to remote and rural communities. Some communities are doing this for themselves. Strong rural communities are raising funds, and in some cases, they're even installing the technology themselves. And this is positive, but what about the less active communities? Those outside towns or those who have no natural leaders, will they be left behind? We need to rethink how we deliver broadband in those areas. What about a social enterprise set up with intention to deliver in more remote regions? We need to make sure that BT, which has received huge amounts of public money, facilitate and support these communities rather than putting barriers in their way. The second phase of the broadband project is now being contracted. We need much more priority given to rural areas, areas of market failure. It's hard to understand why areas that would be served by the market receive government funding, while those who are not served by the market are forced to wait. How much, for example, will the Highlands and Islands get to continue the rollout of broadband as opposed to those in urban Scotland? Rural areas have most to gain by being connected in terms of addressing population decline, about the economic benefits, the telehealth benefits, educational and social benefits. We've not started to reap the benefits of telehealth. Recently, I was told by an 80-year-old constituent that she paid £100 for a taxi to access a hospital appointment. It's too expensive to provide her with patient transport. Why on earth was she not offered a telehealth appointment instead, saving her and the health board a huge amount of money? Education also has much to gain. When I went to high school, I lived away from home. Unfortunately, fewer young people are now being asked to do that. But it's still the case in some places, and indeed in other places, young people choose to travel to access education because the range of education on offer locally is not what they need for their future careers. Surely good broadband can allow children to study closer to home, access their classes online that are not available locally, giving them the same opportunity as others without forcing them away from their homes. Finally, Presiding Officer, without broadband, the rural economy suffers. How can people compete their CAP forms online if they don't have access to broadband? And this brings me to the absolute debacle of the CAP payments. It's unbelievable that a government with plenty of notice cannot set up a computer system that will work. While Audit Scotland report highlighted the very worrying procurement procedures and conflicts, what's more worrying is what's going to happen to the farmers and crofters that are at the mercy of this system. They've been given loan payments, whether or not they wanted them in some cases, to tide them over. But what happens when their claims are not processed and in time to pay those loans off? Will they have to pay interest? Will they lose their subsidy? If the EU penalises the Scottish Government, what budgets are going to be hit? What happens to those who, in the case, who, because of the case that the place they are in, fall foul of state aid rules? All these questions need to be answered, as well as the central question: what on earth is the government going to do to make the system work? What checks and balances are in place in the system to make it happen? And I'm grateful that the Cabinet Secretary took time this morning to speak to opposition spokespeople. And we will work with him to sort out those problems, but they are very urgent and something has to happen. Presiding Officer, I'm honoured to be given the brief in the Scottish Labour Party for the rural economy and connectivity. The health of the rural economy is intertwined with the progress of connectivity, and everything we do depends on this being delivered very, very quickly.
Jenny Gilruth, followed by Bob Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is a privilege to speak today in this Scottish Government debate, indeed as the first of our new SNP MSPs to make a contribution to this chamber. Walking into Holyrood yesterday, a colleague joked to me that only the important MSPs would get to speak today. So, Presiding Officer, I'll take this as a vote of confidence. As the new member for the Mid Fife and Glennothes constituency, I must begin by paying tribute to my predecessor, the Right Honourable Tricia Marwick. Tricia served my constituency with distinction since she was first elected to Holyrood in 1999, when I was 15. And it was in that same year that I sat in my Modern Studies class in Fife and watched the Parliament begin again. We visited Parliament in the General Assembly building later that year, and I remember asking my MSP, then Ian Smith, the member for North East Fife, how his party would get more women into politics. Now, I can't remember exactly what Ian Smith said, but I'm quite sure that even he would not speak favourably of the absence of any women on the Liberal benches today. My passion to teach modern studies was invariably because of my own teachers. I know Alex Hamilton and I share many of the same inspirations in this respect as we attended the same school. Mrs. Broom, Mrs. Brown, and as I am so much younger than Mr. Hamilton, Miss Williamson, who is now the head teacher of Glennothes High School in my constituency. These women taught me to think, they taught me to question, and they all inspired me. Undoubtedly, without their input in my schooling, I would not be here today. When we talk about moving Scotland forward, it's clear to me that we have to begin with education. Indeed, to some extent, we are all linked by school. I know I certainly am in this chamber. To Kezia Dugdale, who I know is not here at the moment, but anyway, whose father was the deputy head at Elgin High School when I was a probationer teacher, and who once interviewed me for the school newspaper, The Pigeon Post. To Alex Rowley, whose nephew I taught until very recently. And to the First Minister herself, in whose constituency my youngest sister teaches physics. None of us want to see a Scotland which creates an unequal playing field. Whether that's on the golf course or in the boardroom, inequality which begins to emerge at the chalk face needs to be tackled head on. That's why I'm proud that this government is committed to targeted funding which will get resources to the schools where it's needed most. Take Warwick Primary School in my constituency, which has already benefited from this government's attainment fund. Nearly £70,000 of Scottish Government funding is going directly into Warwick, benefiting the school and the local area. Under the SNP, the number of probationer teachers has increased every year since 2010. That's good, but we need to work with local councils to make sure these teachers get jobs. Crucially, we need to make sure that we don't lose talent from the education system. I'll give you an example of what I mean by this. This time last year, as a principal teacher, I was involved in interviewing new teachers for Fife Council. If you're applying as a probationer to Fife Council, then you must complete a generic teaching application form. You're then interviewed, and then you wait. You can wait up weeks to find out if you've been successful, and even after that time, you won't necessarily be told which school you're going to. You could be sent to Bell Baxter in Cooper, or to Auchmuty in Glennothes, or to Queen Anne in Dunfermline. That's how it is. Now, I know Fife Council are not alone in this approach nationally, but I've got to ask, who does this recruitment process best serve? This government is committed to empowering local authorities. Head teachers will now have more power to direct resources where they see fit. £750 million is being invested to close the attainment gap. Fundamentally, this government trusts Scotland's teachers to make the right decisions about how best to do so. And much like teaching a class, you also need to assess progress. That's why this government has also invested in a national improvement framework to drive excellence and equality in every Scottish school. This government is also committed to teacher education, ensuring that teachers across Scotland are given the right opportunities to develop professionally by funding the qualification for headship, for example. I've been lucky in my decade in education to have taught in three very different schools: a small community school, a large city centre school, a faith school. I was also fortunate in my time as a teacher to be seconded to Education Scotland, supporting the new qualifications. In every school I've visited or worked in, there has been a sense of community which celebrates success and which works to raise ambition in our young people. It's clear that to move Scotland forward, we need political consensus to do so on education. Curriculum for Excellence was the product of the previous Labour-Liberal coalition. It arose out of the national debate on education when I was in my final year at school. Now, 14 years on, we all have a role to play in making sure it works for this generation and the ones yet to come. Our new Education Secretary wants to listen to teachers. He wants to hear from parents, from unions, and from local authorities. But most of all, John Swinney has made it clear that his mission is to close the attainment gap in Scottish education for every pupil, regardless of their background. Presiding Officer, I don't think that any of us could argue with that. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I call Bob Torres to be followed by Dean Lockhart. Mr. Torres, you're an old hand. 6 minutes, please.
From one old hand to our not so old, of course, new presiding officer in the chair. That's the first and last compliment I'll probably give you, presiding officer. Can I also give a compliment to all the first time speakers that have spoken so far? And I think single out Jerry Goldruth for what is an amazing maiden speech. Well, we're not allowed to see that, of course, now, but an amazing first speech. As a foreign modern studies teacher myself, I would expect it to be of such a high standard, of course, you understand. Ensuring that our children have the best start in life is something that we all want to see. And I became a first-time dad in January this year, having a wee boy, Cameron, with my wife, Janet. So ensuring that best possible start in life for all our children has a very special meaning for myself and my wife more than ever before. And I'm therefore delighted that our Scottish Government's plans by the end of this new Parliament to double existing childcare provision for vulnerable two-year-olds and for all 3- and 4-year-olds are put in place. Whilst it will be challenging to deliver such a step change in preschool childcare provision, the rewards will be significant. They will be great. I believe that in just a few years' time, parents of preschool children having provision of a nursery place for their kids for the same amount of hours as primary school children currently receive today will just be considered the norm, and quite rightly so. The developmental, the health and the educational benefits for our children will be significant. The Scottish Government's priorities to tackle inequalities will also be well served by this policy. Nurturing the fundamental building blocks of childhood development at the earliest possible stage will surely help from the very earliest years tackle the educational attainment gap, something across this chamber we're united to achieve. And I'm particularly pleased that every nursery in our most deprived areas will by 2018 have access to an additional teacher or early years childcare graduate to help in that task. Together with a variety of initiatives, including the baby box for every new parent, the increase of 500 new health visitors, and a new maternity and early years allowance with grants targeted at children in our most deprived areas, I am hugely encouraged by our Scottish Government's early years strategy. It will, of course, help deliver the Scottish Government's ambitions to target gender inequality also. Getting mums and hopefully increasingly dads back to the workforce after taking a career break to bring up their children and not be disadvantaged just by the very fact that they have provided that vital service to society for the first year or so of a child's life is something we should all put our elbow to the wheel and make sure that we deliver. It's how we deliver that maybe I want to spend a little bit of time in relation to. I'm delighted the First Minister said that it has to be flexible. The location of childcare establishments can be a barrier as much as an opportunity for some mums and dads, for some families. And the hours that they open in half-day provision currently can also be a barrier to accessing provision as things currently stand. Although, of course, as we expand the amount of hours, those problems tend to melt away. So I'm encouraged by that also. But we do have to think very carefully of where we locate new childcare establishments. We also have to think carefully about how we use partnership nurseries much more. Local authorities should be the key drivers to plan and deliver childcare provision, but sometimes where their bricks and mortar are just don't serve working parents. And we have to look more carefully at what a local authority may provide a family as a reasonable offer as a childcare placement. I think we have to start with a blank sheet of paper and how we develop that if we're really going to meet the needs of working families and get other families back in to employment. And we also have to plan that childcare structure much more carefully. Right now, in my constituency of Glasgow, Maryhill and Springburn, there is much good work taking place. Let me single out, for example, the work in Royston at the moment, where Rosemount Lifelong Learning provide a vital childcare opportunity. But there's also a group called Royston Youth Action looking at the possibility of a sports hub and an attached childcare facility. If funds are going to be made available in the next few years, let's signpost them at the earliest opportunity so we can do some very careful strategic planning about the best use of public funds to get the biggest bang for the buck and meet the needs of my constituents, deliver the childcare facilities that we need. There are opportunities there and we have to seize those opportunities. In the last minute or so that I have, Presiding Officer, I want to make two brief points away from childcare. I want to welcome the initiative in relation to the £100 million in cancer early detection and treatment, but also to put on record that I think what comes along with that is we have to do far better in relation to palliative care. And I know the Scottish Government's got a new 10-year strategy and framework for palliative care, so I hope in the future when we talk about early intervention in relation to cancer and treatments, we also talk about palliative care, because I think that's vital for a lot of families who have not been quite as fortunate in getting that early intervention. And finally, in Glasgow, there has been significant issues with young people, particularly as they move from nursery schools to primary schools, who have been diagnosed on the autistic spectrum, where they feel there's been a forced mainstreaming of young people into education without the required supports. So I know the Scottish Government signalled in the last session a review of the presumption of mainstreaming legislation, I think, which dates back to 2005. So I think that's very important to make sure that we serve all the young people in primary schools, because a lot of schools right now in Glasgow, I don't think, have the required support to either support those young people with additional support needs, or in fact, perhaps in some occasions, there's a need to expand the specialist school estate also. So lots of opportunities for the future, Presiding Officer, lots of challenges, but together I know this Scottish Government work in partnership to deliver for my constituents in Glasgow, Maryhill and Springburn, and indeed right across Scotland.
Thank you, Mr. Dorris. You didn't take my warning 25 seconds over. I've made a note of it. Can I call Dean Lockhart, please, now followed by Rona Mackay. Mr. Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As one of the new members of the Chamber, it's a great privilege for me to give my first speech in the Chamber and at the same time provide some initial observations on my role as Shadow spokesperson for the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work. In doing so, I would like to congratulate Keith Brown in being appointed as the Cabinet Secretary. I will pass that on when he's back in the Chamber. And I look forward to working with him and his team together in helping to strengthen the Scottish economy. For me personally, it's a great honour to have this economic role. I have spent the last 25 years in business. I've spent time in Hong Kong, Tokyo, a lot of time in Southeast Asia, including China and India, and I would like to bring some of that experience, to the extent possible, some of that experience into the Chamber and bring some new, fresh perspectives on economic policy that will hopefully work for the benefit of the Scottish economy and for Scottish business. Turning to this fifth session of the Scottish Parliament, I think the general mood seems to be that there is a sense of change in the air. Not only do we have a chamber packed with new MSPs, I think more than a third of us are new to this chamber, but we now have significant new powers under the Scotland Act that we can use to really set the future direction of Scotland's business and economy. And I think that's something that we should all embrace. Given this, I think at the start of this term of Parliament, we should all have high ambitions about what we should try to achieve. From an economic perspective, I want to work with everyone in the Chamber to make Scotland once again one of the most dynamic and enterprising economies in the world. I think we have a wealth of talent in this nation, and I really think we should aim high, and we should look to reawaken the spirit of enterprise that this country has been renowned for across the world. And it's really interesting, having spent so much time overseas, people do still look at Scotland as being a country of enterprise and a country where we have been a leader in business. In recent months, I've had the pleasure of meeting a number of businesses across Scotland, and together with Ruth Davison, actually, I met with a number of businesses at the Stirling University Innovation Park. It's a great example of where there's a number of new businesses there in new areas of the economy, digital, IT companies, engineering and software development. And I think it's a great example of how we can support through the places like the Innovation Park, support the creation of new and innovative business in Scotland. From an economic perspective, small and medium-sized businesses are a key part of the economy. There are over 360,000 small and medium-sized businesses in Scotland, and they employ more than 1.2 million people. So that's why it's a fundamental part of the Scottish Conservative policy to support the creation of more small businesses and also encourage the establishment of an export market for those small businesses. We do need this from an economic perspective. The Scottish economy is underperforming compared to the rest of the UK. Unemployment in Scotland is 6.2% compared to 5% for the rest of the UK. And economic growth in Scotland is also lagging behind economic growth in the UK. So with this background, the Scottish Conservative Party has a number of policies that will support business and address the slowdown in the Scottish economy. And let me just highlight a couple of these policies. We aim to propose reforming business rates in Scotland to provide for a more dynamic economy for small and medium-sized businesses. In the North Sea, we've obviously seen real pressure in the North Sea, and the UK Treasury has provided billions of pounds of investment in supporting the North Sea industry, something that would only be possible as being part of the Union and being part of the fifth largest economy in the world and the fastest growing economy in Europe. With 2.3 million new jobs created in the past 6 years, 300,000 of those being in Scotland. We will reverse the increase in the large business supplement that has damaged a number of smaller sized businesses. We also strongly oppose any higher taxation in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK. This would just make Scotland uncompetitive, and it would scare off investment in Scotland and would result in us losing business and a skilled workforce. We'll also address the skills shortages experienced by business. That's a constant feedback we get from business, that they don't have skills in key areas, and that's something we will address. And we will also increase the number of apprenticeships in Scotland. On that note, I'm delighted to summarise and say that my nephew has just completed his apprenticeship. He's now an electrician, and he's looking to start his own business. And that's a real-life example of where this party will help increasing apprenticeships and helping young people establish their own business. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're tight for time, and I don't want to see people slipping off the list, so I'd really ask people, even first-time speakers, to try to keep to the time. Rona Mackay, to be followed by Alec Rowley. Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm deeply honoured to be standing here as the member of our Parliament for Strathkelvin and Bearsden, an area in which I've happily lived for 20 years. I promised the voters during the election campaign that I would work as hard as I possibly could for them if I was elected and be a strong voice in Holyrood as their representative, and I have every intention of doing that. I also feel deeply honoured, of course, to have been given the chance to play a part in taking Scotland forward as part of our progressive Scottish Government, and I will never take that privilege for granted. For me, taking Scotland forward means making life better for everyone, regardless of their background or status. I'm the granddaughter of an immigrant who came to Scotland from the south of Ireland when she was 18 and she couldn't read or write. But she was smart enough to know that to lift her children out of the poverty trap, they had to get an education, which would be their route to a better life. That's why I'm proud that our government has made educational attainment its defining mission. giving every child a better start in life, especially those living in the most deprived areas. An additional £750 million will go to those schools to raise attainment and go straight to head teachers. There will be attainment advisers in every local authority. In Strathkelvin and Bearsden, of course, I'm delighted that we have excellent high-performing schools. But of course, we all know that it's not a level playing field and that some children are not able to fulfil their potential for a variety of reasons. I want every town and city in Scotland to have high-performing schools. But equality for children starts even before they get to school, as many have said today, and many of the poorest children are already behind before they start school. So over the next 5 years, we'll see the transformational increase in the provision of free early learning and childcare to give children the best start in life, which help families and get more women back into work. There's no doubt that these progressive policies will take Scotland forward and reduce the attainment gap. The First Minister has spoken of reaching out across the political divide to achieve consensus on a range of issues that will take Scotland forward and make our country even better. That's why I'm dismayed and disappointed when I hear of the opposition party's intention to scrap two initiatives that attempt to do just that, namely the Offensive Behaviour Act and the Named Persons Act. The Named Persons Act in particular is legislation I passionately support. Having sat in the children's panel in the East End of Glasgow for the last 6 years, I'm appalled at the level of misinformation and scaremongering being disseminated by our opponents. This act is about child protection. It should not be portrayed as controversial or used as a political football. Over the last 6 years in the children's hearing system, I've seen toddlers who've had to be taught how to play because they've been ignored since the day they were born, and babies who cry when they hear someone laugh because they think the shouting and violence around them is starting again. Presiding officer, they are the lucky ones. They're the ones who are in the system, who are being cared for and protected. So many more children slip through the net, and this act is an extra layer of protection for them. Children's charities across the board are in favour of it, so why don't those who are so against it listen to the people who are in the front line? Community empowerment is something else I strongly believe in, and over the past 2 weeks I've been meeting with community councils throughout the constituency. I've been amazed at the amount of work and time people put in just to make their community better. I've met people who can only be described as local heroes, without whom our society would only half function. That's why I'm pleased that through the Community Empowerment Act we will recognise the great work that they do and give them a voice. Tonight I've been asked to present certificates at a graduation ceremony for modern apprenticeships run by Tigers, whose head office is in Bishopbriggs in my constituency, and who have just won Growth Business and Overall Business of the Year at Eastern Bartonshire's annual Business Awards. I'm thrilled to be asked to do that because these are the young people that will take Scotland forward. They are our future, and I'm proud that our government has increased the number of modern apprenticeships and is building on progressive initiatives to get more young people into work. As a new MSP, I'm becoming aware of the great trust people have put in all of us to help them and the expectation on our shoulders to do that. I will take my lead from my former boss, Gil Paterson, who could not have set a better example for me to follow. I thank the voters of Strathkelvin and Bearsden for putting their trust in me, and I will do my utmost every day not to let them down.
Thank you very much. Call Alec Rowley, be followed by Graham Day. Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by congratulating you on your new post?
And you're going to top of my list.
And also to congratulate all those who have made their maiden speeches today. I'm quite clear that where we can work together for the betterment of our country and for the people of our country, then we should be able to do so. I think that's what the people of Scotland expect, and also it is the right thing to do. I did think, we've been talking this morning to quite a few people this afternoon about teachers, I did think as I listened and read through the First Minister's speech that if I were a teacher and this was an essay that was setting out some of the key priorities for Scotland, then I would be ticking most of the sentences as we were going through. The issue, I think, is not what's been set out here, but how it will be delivered and will it be delivered? And I suppose, therefore, the report cards, and we need to ensure that this Parliament holds the government to account, not in 5 years' time, but on a regular basis to actually see what is being delivered. And if I could turn to a few points. Bruce Crawford talked about earlier in his speech about building a national consensus. I believe that we need to build a national consensus in this country that sets out why austerity is so bad for this country and for the future of this country. And we need to be clear that I certainly would not point the finger at the government in Scotland for creating austerity. That is the responsibility of the Tories in London, and it is a responsibility that they have driven forward based on ideology and based on reducing the role of the state with no regard for the people that austerity will impact upon. Worse than that, what we've seen is over this last few years is austerity is actually failing and it's pulling Scotland back. Indeed, it's pulling the whole United Kingdom back. So we should be building a consensus in Scotland that opposes austerity because it's bad for Scotland. But we should also build a consensus in Scotland around the idea that you cannot have Scandinavian type public services whilst paying American levels of taxation. And if we want to have good public services in Scotland, then we need to have the investment in those services. If you take, for example, the First Minister talks about reforming our public services to make them fit for the challenges of tomorrow. Now, I would not be opposed to that. I do believe that there is real opportunity to reform public services and drive the economy forward. But you will not reform public services if they are driven, those reforms are driven by cuts. Yesterday I talked with the leader of Fife Council who said to me that this year they're looking at over 400 job losses taken out of Fife Council. If you multiply that across local government, then this year alone there is going to be thousands of jobs taken out of local government. And if you look at the picture of cuts and austerity being served up for the Tories in Westminster, then in years to come there's going to be even more job losses. At a time when unemployment in Scotland rose by 20,000 between December and February to stand at 171,000 people unemployed in Scotland. Youth unemployment has risen by 2.5, up to 2.5% since 2008. That is young people in their thousands being denied any opportunity and any prospects for the future. Over the past year, Scotland is the only country in the UK to have a fallen employment rate. So we need to tackle unemployment, we need to give people opportunity, but we will not do that by the levels of cuts that are taking place in our public sector across Scotland. And if we look at, for example, the National Health Service, the First Minister acknowledges that we have a problem in terms of GPs. The Royal College of General Practitioners, they say that we have a crisis in terms of GPs moving forward in Scotland. Again, I certainly want to, my party want to work with the government to look at how do we tackle that. This week I met with some retired GPs who tell me that they would be, in the short term, able to start to try and fill some of those gaps, but the bureaucracy that is involved in them trying to come back into the service and provide service on a part-time basis is far too great. So we need to tackle that. In Fife, where I live, the NHS Fife a few weeks ago announced £30 million out of their budget moving forward. How they're going to do that without impacting on already pressured services, people just don't understand. The First Minister talked about the new health and social care partnerships. In Fife, the health and social care partnership are starting with £11 million off a deficit.
So we have major challenges in all these services that will need investment, yes, public sector reform, but also will need investment moving forward. I also just very briefly wanted to mention the housing proposals that are in
here. I'm sorry, Mr. Rowley.
I would just say we need a national plan for housing. We have a housing crisis in Scotland, so let's work together to deliver these plans.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm having to be a bit curt, but I don't want, as I say, people are waiting to speak to find they don't get the opportunity. I'm going to now call Graham Day to be followed by Annie Wells. Mr. Day.
Thank you. 5 years ago, I rose to make my first speaking contribution in the last session of Parliament with a mixture of nerves, excitement and pride. Today, the nerves may have gone, but the pride and the excitement remains. Genuine excitement at what the next 5 years holds as this SNP government seeks to move Scotland forward, and pride in the First Minister's announcement today that the government will explore the introduction of a young carer's allowance. That represents the kind of Scotland I want to see built. Presiding officer, the Cabinet Secretaries and the Ministers are now in post, and very shortly, backbenchers like myself will find out their committee roles, allowing Parliament to get down to business. Some of that business will be a legacy from the last Parliament. The raft of secondary legislation for the Land Reform Act will certainly occupy the time of members of the new committee charged with effective scrutiny of that. That's something personally I'd welcome being involved in, although a role potentially made more challenging because of the impact of the recent election on the ranks of former RACI committee members. During stage three debate on the then bill, I highlighted the loss through their opting to stand down of the vast experience of the Land Reform Act process of Rob Gibson, Alex Ferguson and Dave Thompson. The outcome of the election has subsequently seen the Parliament deprived of the knowledge and the commitment of Jim Hume and Sarah Boyack. And as a former committee colleague of theirs, let me acknowledge the contribution of both to the RACI committee and the wider work of Parliament over an extended period. Of course, fresh talent and fresh perspective will be introduced to the successor committee, indeed all the committees of the Parliament, and I'm sure that will be a benefit to this place. The contributions of Maurice Golden, Jenny Gorruth and others today certainly suggest that will be the case. Presiding officer, can I say I'm particularly enthused by the prospect of a new climate change bill being introduced and developed in the course of the session. And that's an enthusiasm shared out there by environmental NGOs, stakeholders. Those of whom I've spoken to are delighted at the message the appointment of a cabinet secretary with responsibility for climate change and environment sends that these are matters the Scottish Government sees as a priority. WWF Scotland, for example, I know view the bringing forward of a new climate change bill as a welcome opportunity to focus the whole Parliament on tackling climate change, to reset our ambitions and to embed carbon reduction progress across all sectors of the economy. If you don't mind, I want to make some progress. The 2009 Act won Scotland and its Parliament many plaudits. Its ambitions and indeed progress in delivery of those ambitions continues to win admiration from around the globe. But the fact is, in part admittedly through baseline adjustments, we have missed those early targets. So a reset is required, especially as evidence of the developing nature of climate change grows even more obvious. So looking to achieve greenhouse gas emission reduction of at least 50%, especially if we move to territorial emissions accounting by the end of this session, is an appropriate move. As the First Minister said, we must be bolder. The development of a new energy strategy alongside this is a further positive move, and I would encourage the Government to consider the content of RSPB's 2050 Energy Report, which I spoke at the launch of last night, for it offers constructive, evidence-based proposals for decarbonising our energy supply without harming wildlife. But just as there is widespread support among stakeholders for both of these actions, so there is a desire for information on just how the Climate Change Bill will interact with the development of RPP3. If memory serves, the UK CCC is due to provide advice on the targets for 2028 to 2032 around October of this year, with development of RPP3 to follow thereafter. People are keen to glean an understanding of whether RPP3 and the planned Climate Change Bill will be developed in parallel or dovetail with each other. They're looking for timescales. And whilst understanding fully that the government has only just been re-elected, hopefully this information will be forthcoming, to use that phrase so beloved of the Climate Change Act 2009, as soon as reasonably practical. Turning to entirely different matters, Presiding Officer, just as the appointment to the Cabinet of Rosanna Cunningham has met with widespread approval among stakeholders, so has the Scottish Government's appointment of a dedicated Minister for Mental Health in Maureen Watt. Equally welcome is the additional investment in this area, the move towards putting in place a new 10-year plan for mental health provision and recruiting more community-based mental health workers. But the impact of that messaging and commitment at Scottish Government level has to be felt on the ground. And as the Health Ministers will be aware, there are moves by NHS Tayside to close one of its three inpatient units, which is causing considerable concern among service users and their families in Angus. And community-based day patient provision across the county is a long way short of what it requires to be. I look forward to seeing the Scottish Government's leadership, backed up as it is being by additional funding, being followed and appropriate mental health services maintained, extended and delivered, not just in Angus but across wider Tayside. The planned increase in the number of modern apprenticeships is another very positive commitment by this government, which will be of benefit to the part of the country that I'm privileged to represent and others. But I hope that within that we can see a recognition of the specific needs of rural businesses and young people from out with urban conurbations, particularly more remote rural areas that can be difficult to secure year-round employment with one employer. Youngsters seeking to remain in the areas they were born and raised in may well have to develop multiple skills across a range of areas. The RACI committee in the last parliament highlighted the need to take a more flexible approach with MAs, allowing participants to have more than one employer if that were required in rural settings. I hope to see this taken forward in the course of the new parliamentary session. It would be of real benefit to rural areas. In terms of facilitating our young people to carve out careers in rural settings, so too will be the delivery of 100% access to superfast broadband and the commitment to delivering affordable homes in rural areas. Presiding officer, the manifesto in which the SNP stood was a positive, exciting manifesto for every part of Scotland. That's why we were re-elected for a historic third time. Now I look forward to seeing us delivering that manifesto.
Thank you, Mr. Day. I now call Annie Wells to be followed by Christina McKelvey. Ms. Wells.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. When I introduced Ruth at our manifesto launch in April, I said that it would be my dream to be sworn in as the MSP for my home city of Glasgow. Dreams come true, and I'm the proof of that. Until the 5th of May, the shop floor of Marks and Spencers was my workplace rather than the floor of this chamber. My busiest day was Christmas Eve, but I suspect that the pre-Christmas rush in M&S is going to be more like your typical day in the Scottish Parliament. I know it is customary in these speeches to pay tribute to my predecessors. As a regional list MSP, it's hard to pay tribute to any one individual. We have seen over the years since this Parliament was formed a broad spectrum of people and parties representing Glasgow, from big characters in Labour and the SNP to representatives from the smaller parties such as the SSP, the Greens, and even a Lib Dem. So I'm delighted to say that for the first time, I am the second regional list MSP elected to serve my home city as a Scottish Conservative and Unionist. Surely an indication of how Scotland and indeed Glasgow has changed since devolution and will change further in this new powerhouse parliament. At this stage, I must point out, I'm not, however, the first person in this chamber to cut their teeth in the Glasgow North East constituency and then go on to represent Glasgow region in this parliament. I have the very skilled footsteps of our leader, Ruth Davison, to follow in. Over the years, Glasgow has been sending MSPs to this parliament. Much has changed in Scotland. We banned smoking in public places, brought about equal marriage, an issue very close to my heart, the equal marriage, and we've hosted a successful Commonwealth Games. But there are many things which have not changed for the better. Glaswegians have a desire to take a different approach to tackle issues such as low life expectancy, poor housing, stalling levels of social justice, and the deep inequality between the best and lowest performing state schools in Glasgow. People want an alternative Conservative agenda, which was demonstrated by the surge in support which my party received 3 weeks ago. The fact that I am joined in this chamber by my talented and skilled colleague, Adam Tompkins, who I look forward to working closely to address these problems and hold the Scottish Government to account. It is also customary to comment on your constituency, and Glasgow is my home and it always has been. It's where I was born, bred, raised my son and have spent most of my adult life. It's a great honour to represent the city, which was the workhorse of the United Kingdom, a place of trade and merchants, inventors and scientists, poets and artists. It is often said that people make Glasgow, and it's true. And I will work to make my home city stronger, and I will support the policies which make the people powerful rather than the state. It's also a great privilege to represent the city of Glasgow as a Scottish Conservative. I have been a Conservative all my life, even though I only realised it recently. Like many, I have challenged the stereotypes of your working class in Glaswegian, therefore you must vote Labour. I look at other people who are coming forward to support and indeed join our party, and I saw people who were just like me and were reflective of Scotland as a whole. It's a sign that nothing will be the same after this historic referendum, which confirms Scotland's place at the heart of our United Kingdom. And I fully recognise that many people who voted for my party and helped elect me did so after never voting Scottish Conservative in the past, or perhaps doing so for the first time in many years. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank them. The election result that put us on this side of the chamber for the first time, that wasn't just an event which took place on May the 5th. It was the start of significant change in Scotland. It saw the coming together of people who want an alternative proposal to our health services, our colleges, our schools and our transport infrastructure. I am personally looking forward to getting on with the job in hand and scrutinising the SNP government, especially on issues that matter most to me. I will look to stand up for hard-working people, strive to strengthen local communities and to address inequality wherever it may be found. Some of the issues that are particularly important to me include strengthening community engagement and ensuring a greater degree of localised participation in decision making. We should aim to encourage as many people as we can from across all walks of life to get involved and make their community a better place. As I am sure is the case with many members, I can think of numerous third sector organisations in Glasgow that do fantastic work in their local communities, but more can be done to encourage and provide support for these organisations. As I alluded to earlier, much progress has been made in terms of tackling inequalities. However, I'm keenly aware that there are still hurdles to overcome. In particular, I believe that more action can be taken to address LGBT discrimination. For instance, I would like to see the school inspections asked specifically about school action on LGBT issues, as opposed to simply broad equality matters. I am also aware that teachers are often unsure about how to tackle homophobic and transphobic bullying, and I would therefore like to encourage the development of a toolkit in cooperation with the third sector that we could give the teachers the confidence to take the lead in this area. I was elected in a platform of providing a strong opposition, and that's what I endeavour to do over the next 5 years. By providing a strong opposition, I can play my part in building a stronger Glasgow and a stronger Scotland. I recognise that I was elected to serve the people of Glasgow rather than one party. Therefore, I look forward to working constructively with members from all parties as we seek to make Glasgow the best city in the world to live and work. Glaswegians were reaching out for change, and my own election was part of that. And I will not let you, your family, nor your community down. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Christina McKelvey, followed by Neil Findlay. Ms. McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I welcome you to your new chair, but I fear it will not allow me to take your usual chair behind the First Minister of First Minister's questions. I'm sure you'll still have your towel down for that, Presiding Officer. But I do welcome you to your new place.
I just say you've mystified the new members.
I welcome you to your new place and that of Linda Fabiani and Ken McIntosh. Can I also pay tribute to the new members who have spoken today? Your contributions have been very enlightening, very, you know, lots of detail in there about what your aspirations are for this place, and standing together, this place usually does make a difference, and I look forward to working with you over the next 5 years. Deputy Presiding Officer, we come to elections, we set out our stall, we have our manifestos, we sell an ideal, a dream. And more importantly, we give people some hope. Hope for a better life, a better country to live in. And my constituents in Hamilton, Larkhall and Stonehouse put that trust in me. So, whether you're a young person seeking enlightenment at university or college, or a career through our 30,000 apprenticeships, or just a chance to prove yourself in a job opportunity, this government has that vision for you. If you're an elderly person who wants safety, security, liberation through public transport and personal independence to live at home, and most importantly, care in your twilight years, this government has something for you. A person seeking employment or training, or a business start-up support, or rates relief to build and establish your existing business, we have something for you. Whether you're seeking that wee break, you know the one that will make things a bit easier, make us more successful, possibly in the form of a jobs grant, we have that for our 16 to 24-year-olds. And if you're in a job, you're looking for a job, our people expect nothing less than the living wage. with good employee relations through our Fair Work agenda, and certainly the right to be a member of a trade union unfettered by Tory regressive trade union laws. Like the parent, presiding officer, returning to work, the workplace, because we have provided childcare equivalent to a full school week, and not just term time, but throughout the summer as well. Or a maternity or early years grants and the much lauded and life-saving baby box. Giving our youngsters the best start in life is a key priority of this government. Or when it comes to healthcare, our people want a national health service that responds when they need it. Cradle to the grave, I believe a wise man once said. Our commitment to free prescriptions will ease many minds when challenged by its illness or disability. And presiding officer, when faced with adversity in your health, like motor neuron disease, they look to us to provide care, support, and they will look, like I will, for those PhD research posts promised in our manifesto to find a cure, or at the very least some advancement in diagnosis, treatment and care. And presiding officer, when we are battered about like debris in a tsunami of horrifying welfare reforms, we have promised the sanctuary of a social security system that cares, not castigates, that respects, not punishes, and that operates with dignity and not disdain. Not a system that asks a woman to prove her rape before awarding benefits for her child. And if you're a victim of domestic abuse, this government will strengthen that law and define that crime of domestic abuse, something I look very much forward to. Presiding officer, our peoples will look for support in our unsung heroes, our carers, by increasing carers' allowance to that of job seekers' allowance. You have no idea of the impact that will have on the people I know in the South Lanarkshire Carers Network and how hard they work to ensure that their carers are looked after. Or maybe protecting disability benefits from means testing, not penalising parents whose child is in hospital by abolishing the 84-day rule and giving peace of mind by awarding those children eligible for DLA that benefit until they are 18 years of age. The pressure taken off families with just those few measures will be enormous. Or what about equality, presiding officer? Equality should be the watermark of this place, of our parliament. Whether it's your gender, your disability, your sexuality, your race, or your faith, that's why we need to work together to ensure that our hard-fought-for Human Rights Act is not repealed. Presiding officer, we will build bridges and roads, not just over our rivers and through and connecting our towns, and I have to make special mention of the works going on at the Wraith Interchange project. But those roads and bridges will be built into and over our communities by empowering our people to take control of their local communities, to enable them to build capacity and resilience into the places where they live, work and play. People put faith and trust in us. Yes, we very privileged 129 members of our parliament. They expect us to live up to that faith and repay that trust. Presiding officer, my friends in the Scottish Government have a very difficult task, and I know my colleagues across the chamber and other parties have a difficult task in opposition to, but we have been given that task by the people of Scotland, and it's a task that I believe we can all step up to. So, be bold, be courageous, be brave, because the people of this land, our Scotland, demand and deserve nothing less.
Thank you. I call Neil Findlay to be followed by Derek Mackay, who will be the last speaker this afternoon. Mr Findlay.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's an honour to be returned to this Parliament to represent the Lothian region, and I welcome all the new members to Parliament. The Labour Party has much thinking to do, but we also have many causes that need championed in this Parliament, and more importantly, championed in our communities. And for my part, I intend continuing the campaign and work that I started in the last session. Since Parliament went into recess, there have been major developments in many of these areas. I think all of us would have been humbled to see the result of the Hillsborough inquiry. And that verdict wasn't just justice for the families in the great city of Liverpool, but it will inspire class justice campaigners across the world who are seeking justice. And in the back of Hillsborough, The call for an inquiry into Orgreave and the arrest of the police in the miners' strike grows louder and louder, with Tory MPs writing to the Home Secretary just today demanding that. And proportionately more miners were arrested and convicted in Scotland than anywhere else, many victims of a miscarriage of justice. So post-Hillsborough and all that we know now, the Scottish Government should stop obstructing the legitimate calls for a Scottish inquiry into these cases. And also in the last few weeks, we've seen 250 blacklisted construction workers sharing £10 million in compensation. But there will be no justice until all of those victims are paid out and the guilty directors of Carillion, of Balfour Beatty, of Castaigne, of Keir, of Langer Oak, of Sir Robert McAlpine, of Skanska UK and Vinci are brought to justice in the courts. Until then, the Scottish Government and public bodies should stop handing out public contract after public contract to these guilty companies. And week in and week out, we unearth more and more evidence of the Scottish links to the undercover policing scandal. The Pitchford inquiry must be expanded to take in Scotland, and if it's not, there is a moral obligation on the Scottish Government to hold a Scottish inquiry. It will not be acceptable that English and Welsh victims will have access to an inquiry, yet Scots won't. How on earth is that standing up for Scotland? And I will also continue to campaign on behalf of those courageous women who have to live with a chronic pain as a result of surgical mesh. They've been let down by the government, by regulators, by manufacturers, and by some in the medical profession who enjoy a far too cosy relationship with the all-power pharmaceutical industry. But today's debate is about priorities. In my region and during the election, the priorities of the voters were health and the public services in general. So how can we create a modern preventative healthcare system that tackles health inequality when NHS Lothian itself has a black hole of £90 million? What will happen to patients in my region if the NHS end their legally binding waiting times guarantee as is reported in the media? How will the loss of between 200 and 400 beds across Lothian help delay discharge? What do we say to people in Livingston and other areas of the Lothians who cannot get a GP appointment because of the crisis in our surgeries? And what do we do about the social care system, a social care system that fails our older people and those who care for them? And how do we stop people dying young in our poorest communities? If we as a parliament and we as a society know what's killing those people early and we do little or nothing about it, then this parliament is complicit in those early deaths and we must face up to that. So, Presiding Officer, the public services are the services that civilise our society. The people who work in them, who educate our children, who clean our streets, who look after the vulnerable, are the essential glue that holds our society together. At my election count, I heard and I saw on TV politician after politician praising the hard work of the council staff who help administer the election. Most of the people here would have done that. But many of these same politicians will have went in to this chamber year after year and voted for budget cut after budget cut and will probably do so again, putting some of those very same workers out of work, cutting their hours or continuing with below inflation pay deals. That's the hypocrisy that people are watching. So, Presiding Officer, in this Parliament, I will argue for public services. I will oppose cuts and privatisation. I'll argue for fair funding for local government. Let's not hear claims that in the NHS, a 1% increase in the NHS budget is anywhere near enough, when health inflation runs at 7%. Let's not hear that we're claims that we're overfunding local government when we've lost 70,000 jobs. So I will argue for progressive taxation. I'll argue that we use the powers of this Parliament to challenge current economic orthodoxy. I'll argue that we protect our environment. I'll argue for an end to the cuts that damage the life chances of young people. And I'll reject the politics that refuses to address these key issues
and instead waves a flag and pretends it will all be okay. Well, my constituents can't feed their kids with a flag. They can't pay their gas bill with a salt tyre, and they can't keep a roof over their head with the flutter of a Union Jack. People need answers, not symbols and empty rhetoric.
Thank you very much. I now call Derek Mackay, Cabinet Secretary. You have till 4:59 or thereabouts.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And let me try and find the consensus of the day, which I think has largely featured in much of the debate that we have had, following on from Neil Findlay, that champion of parliamentary consensus. But can I, first of all, congratulate all those members who have given their first speeches. I'll make some reflections there, but also welcome all the opposition spokespeople to their post, and particularly to Kezia Dugdale on her self-appointed promotion to opposition finance spokesperson for the Labour Party. I look forward to you representing the Labour Party in that role. In terms of the first speeches of the members, I'll do it in order in which they have spoken. Maurice Golden gave a very impressive CV on environmental matters, and I saw Murdo Fraser looking with great interest to those environmental concerns and that very impressive CV that was outlined. To Richard Leonard, asking about the government's economic strategy, I'm very familiar with that strategy and happy to share it with the member. And the member fairly asks about government interventions when they are required. And I'd simply say, ask the steelworkers or the workers at Ferguson's what this government does when those outside the public sector require our support, not to mention, of course, the preferred bidder status for CalMac itself, my last act as Transport Minister. And touch very importantly on housing, to which this government had an excellent record in house building and supporting that sector in very, very difficult times, and we've set out aspirations in housing as well. But those are the right kind of issues, of course, for this government to reflect upon. Gordon Lyndhurst spoke about the importance of broadband, as did many other members, and that's fair and absolutely correct. That is the infrastructure of the future that will unlock different kinds of economic development. But I would want to say at that point, Rhoda Grant did ask how it was possible that we would meet our manifesto commitment for 100% rollout of broadband. I don't think that was a commitment matched, incidentally, by the Labour Party or any other party, but we did meet our targets. We actually met our targets ahead of schedule, so I am confident that we'll continue to deliver on our commitments around broadband. Jenny Gilruth, I thought, gave a very powerful speech on gender, on education, and the connectedness of the right interventions in terms of the life chances of our children. I thought that was an incredibly powerful speech that was given for us all to reflect upon this afternoon. Dean Lockhart spoke about the sense of change in the chamber with many new members, but some things haven't changed. Tory members will now have to reflect on how to play a Parliament bingo in terms of George Adam, how many times you can mention Paisley, but it sounds as if Annie Wells might be competing in terms of how many times Annie Wells can mention Glasgow and her Glasgow roots. But just a word of caution, I know you're happy with the results in Glasgow, but the SNP did actually win every constituency in the city of Glasgow. Rona Mackay gave a very impressive speech around education and childcare, and of course, child protection and the connections there. Many other members have focused on the priorities for government that have been outlined by the First Minister. Of the opposition leaders, important points around the consensus that we can build on a progressive alliance and the policies that are right for Scotland. And Patrick Harvey saying that he won't simply make demands, because simply making demands won't work. And I have to tell you, as the Cabinet Secretary with responsibility for the budget, that is music to my ears, that there won't be simply a set of demands. But I'm afraid I don't have time on this occasion, Mr. Harvey, in terms of, well, there will be many other occasions. So I appreciate the pledge around a positive, constructive approach. And that was also the theme very much of, if not all the content, from Willie Rennie, Kezia Dugdale, and Ruth Davidson. But there are many things on which we can agree and find that common ground. and that consensus on many of the subject areas that we have described. But Willie Rennie did repeat the plea of, you know, you produce too many plans, but where are your plans? And then asked us, what are we doing about certain issues? It can't be just about appointing a minister. You have to put your money where your mouth is. And that's why, following on from the priorities of government, there will be spending commitments, some of which have been outlined in the speech, including new resources for the NHS in real terms, in terms of mental health, in terms of education, the attainment fund, and in many other areas where there's not just a political focus, but there are new resources to match the reality of the political commitment that has been attached by our First Minister. Setting out from a, not on this occasion, setting out from a manifesto in which the SNP won the Scottish Parliament elections, but of course we will have to reach out to all parties in the chamber to deliver our joint aspirations and in the many areas that we agree, not least on addressing inequality, because the First Minister has made it perfectly clear in all the themes that run through our priorities of government that equality of opportunity is the key driver and is the key principle that we will deliver upon to build a fairer and a welfare country that we all want to see. So this is the beginning of the blueprint for delivery in transforming Scotland, in public service reform, in delivering the economic growth that will fund the interventions that can support our public services to allow us to deliver the kind of Scotland that we all want to create. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mackay. And can I remind all members who have spoken to be present in the chamber for concluding remarks in the debate tomorrow afternoon when this debate continues. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 183 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move Motion 183.
Formally moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I will now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 183 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. That motion is agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of four parliamentary bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 184 on First Minister's questions, portfolio and general questions, motion 185 on the variation of standing orders, motion 186 on the Office of the Clerk, and Motion 187 on Parliamentary Recess Dates. Can I ask Mr. Fitzpatrick to move these motions?
Moved on block.
The question on these motions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. I propose to ask a single question on motion numbers 184 to 187 on various procedural issues relating to question time, the Office of the Clerk, and Parliamentary Recess Dates. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No members objected. Therefore, I put the question that motions 184 to 187 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. That concludes decision time.